We're very fortunate to have Heidi Peterson with us from Mobility Outreach International. Welcome, Heidi.
Thank you very much.
Tell us about Mobility Outreach International as to what you do.
Absolutely, and thank you for having me. Mobility Outreach International is nearly 30 years old. It was founded in Seattle, Washington by Dr. Ernie Burgess. He's since passed, but he had a chair position at the University of Washington, and we were very fortunate to have a great relationship help kick off this work. Today we work across three different continents in places like Southeast Asia, Vietnam, places like Sierra Leone in Africa, and Haiti in the Western Hemisphere. And our goal is to bring mobility to the greatest number of people that we can serve.
When I hear mobility, I hear somebody driving buses. Is that you?
That is not quite us. We really believe in helping people to walk. So people with lower limb deformities, maybe you were born with club foot, and which affects children across the globe, even here in the United States. But in the developing world, only about 4 out of every 5 children born with club foot actually gets treated, which leads to a lifetime of disability, walking on your feet turned backwards. Mm. So with some basic casting, we can prevent that with as little as $250 and give that person a lifetime free of neglected club foot.
Some of the countries that I heard you talk about, Vietnam and Sierra Leone in particular, we have covered here on Rainmakers in the past. Because of civil war, because of other really horrific circumstances, children particularly lost limbs.
That's right.
Is the work that you are doing in so many of these kinds of countries, is that what you're finding as opposed to club foot? Are you finding instead injuries?
You know, at the origin of our organization in 1989, there was a large contingent of people here in the Northwest who cared very much about providing some help back to Vietnam, and that's really where we started. We were seeing people with the loss of a limb, walking on really terrible makeshift devices. In fact, I have an example that I think I can show you. So we were finding things like this. This would be an example of a leg that somebody who had perhaps lost their limb through a landmine or a disability of some kind. Many of our patients were landmine victims, and there was a social conscience here in Seattle to take this sort of approach and do what we can to improve the local situation. So let me show you what a mono limb looks like today. This is an example of something we would create, and we have created since then. And there's a lot of important pieces to this. For example, in places like Vietnam, the components to make this limb get expensive, the more complex it gets. So we call this a monolimb, which means this socket is specifically engineered for the individual person wearing it. And this saves a great deal of money, and it also allows us to do a great deal of local production. Yeah. People providing prosthesis to our patients really like that because they can repair things that are made locally. And our whole goal at Mobility Outreach is not to create conditions of dependency. We really want people to become permanently sustainable in their own local marketplace so they can get these services themselves long after we're gone.
But prosthetics can cost thousands of dollars.
They can. But here's another example of something. We could make this for well under $400. And this one's a great example because people care about the way it looks. They don't want a white foot if they have tan skin. So this would be really important for the self-esteem of a child to feel and look like other people around them. And again, you're seeing the monolimb that's very easy to manufacture in a local environment.
Help us live through you. Help us understand what it feels like to be able to deliver this solution to a person who has had to deal with that metal thing.
You know, just a few months ago, our organization was referred a patient named Figgy. And Figgy is a gentleman, young man now, but at the time was a child and lost his limb in the 2010 Haiti earthquake. It was shocking to me to realize that since 2010 until just a few months ago, he has been walking around on crutches. And Figgy loves basketball. He absolutely loves playing the game. And to see him lean on his crutch with the stump of his leg so he could shoot a hoop, was heartbreaking. We were able to fit him with a prosthesis once we found out about him, got him closer to where we deliver services. And today, not only can he walk, but he dribbles. And he loves playing the game. And so to see a child light up and to feel like other people and to feel that there's hope and opportunity, there's nothing better than that.
I suspect there's probably a strong demand for your services, particularly in Africa, where as a matter of their civil wars, they cut off limbs.
That's absolutely true. And a good example of that is Sierra Leone. Unfortunately, we serve both man-made and natural disasters, and Sierra Leone is a place where a lot of people lost their limbs during the terrible war. They now have more access to not only prosthetics and orthotics, but we have also created independent businesses that allow people from the disabled community to have the assets to start a small business that they eventually run and own themselves. And they do repairs for people and fittings for people that might not live close to the capital. So it allows these services to get further down the end of the last mile so that you can serve people that would have been overlooked otherwise.
What's the biggest challenge that you've had in making this all work, making it happen?
I appreciate that question, because I think one thing that nonprofits often face, and we're a very small organization, we only have about $1 million budget, it's the peak and valley of the revenue that comes in. We have really wonderful grantors and really very supportive foundations that are part of our family of supporters. But we really aren't very well known, and we don't have a huge marketing budget, and it's difficult for people to know about our work and learn what we do. If we could increase the number of people who support us, even at $50 a month, you're talking about being able to provide a prosthetic limb for a child in the course of a year, maybe even two children in the course of a year for only $50 a month. So for me, if we could increase the number of people who are aware, increase the number of people who can partner with our organization, that would be a tremendous outcome in terms of our future growth and ability to serve more people.
How can they help? This is an opportunity to ask them.
Thank you so much. Well, if you're interested to support our work, you can learn more about us online at mobilityoi.org, and you'll find an area of our website where you can let us know about you, and you can even make a donation, or feel free to pick up the phone. We'd love to hear from you. We care very much about partners, not just pockets.
But we're not going to end here, though. This is not just a one-shot deal. You actually, in addition to helping people form businesses, you've got a sustainability piece that's part of Mobility Outreach International.
Absolutely. We want very much to avoid creating conditions of dependency where we just have more people who expect another handout. That's not at all who we are or what we do. We're all about sustainability.
Bon, moi t'es toujours pensé pour me gagner, même pas tant qu'on qui moi me voit pas assez pour me joindre.
Et moi help the community in many, so many things. We have processes that we are giving to people free in charge.
Mais faut y gen des moun qui prepare, des moun qui capable tout, qui capable aider moun sa yo pour yo capable reprendre activité.
Bon, je dis à, pour moi c'est un grand jour. Pour moi, c'est une fête dans laquelle c'est la première fois que je marche avec.
It's our goal that the local providers have better training, have increased skill sets, have better access to the materials and the supply chain that they need to be successful to do their jobs. Our goal is to come in and do that training and do those supply chain fixes so that we can help them to become sustainable long after our support's gone, so that we can go to other places where our help is needed.
Heidi, thank you very much for being with us.
Thank you very much.
Rainmaker believes we can change the world. One life, one heart.